Good evening and welcome to the 2023 Workplace Summit Gala. Welcome to our MC for the evening, an artist, activist, and Tony Award-winning Broadway star, and beloved member of the Out and Equal family, Paul Oakley Stovall.
What's up, Out and Equal? Yeah. Sit down. Right? I'm no Laverne Cox, but I think this is kind of cute. Everybody's still settling. Settle. How's everybody doing tonight? Woo! What a week it has been, Out and Equal Global Summit attendees. Have we had a great week? Everybody feel good about this week? Yeah. I know y'all have had a good week because I was here all this week and I attended as many plenaries and gatherings and sessions as I could, including, wait a minute, let me give you all a chance to settle. Who loves Beyonce? Look around, everybody on mute. Pretty good. So I want to include last night's night out in Disney at Animal Kingdom Theme Park, sponsored by Sodexo. We want to thank them. Are there some, yeah. It was a hot, dark, muggy night and an amazing night. And I have a quick story. I'm not an amusement park person at all. I don't ride rides. And I was with Carson Tuller. Everybody remember Carson Tuller, who told us that wonderful story? One of our heroes this week. So me and Carson were like, yeah, we're not going on the rides. Y'all go ahead and go on the rides. And everybody was coming off looking like they had so much fun. And we just looked at each other and I said, well, I'll go if you go. So we did it. And we had so much fun. Screamed so loud, they heard me in Miami. When we got off the ride, we looked around a little bit and said, you want to go again? We went twice. So like they said, my name is Paul Oakley Stovall, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. I made this. No, I'm just kidding. I was raised as a high-performance, upper-middle-class, black suburban kid by high-performance, upper-middle-class, working black parents. I was in all the clubs at school, every sports team. I could fit into the schedule, student government, mathletes, theater, you name it, I did it. But of course, back then, I didn't realize I was such a joiner because I was dancing as fast as I could for fear of standing still and seeing myself. We all know that feeling. Now, my upper middle class black parents just knew I was going to be in finance, computer science, chemical engineering. I know a lot of you know what that's about, something of that nature. And let me say, I was not a reluctant high performance student. I love math, I love science, I love physics, I love all that stuff. And to this day, I think that that has influenced the decision to become an artist. And it influences my acting and my singing and my writing. You know, liberal arts and science, we can't have, you know, our best artists, our good scientists, and our best scientists respect the arts. So I'm old enough to see how all those things actually work together for my artistry. All right, fast forward. Graduated from Acting Conservatory in Chicago, landed a lead role right out of school, and 6 days into rehearsal, the apartment I was staying in was broken into and I got shot in both my legs. And I was left for dead, bleeding out, alone. Obviously, it has a happy ending. You see me standing here today. I was found and I went through therapy, was in a wheelchair for a little while, but I'm here. I was saved. Lucky me. So you figured that part out. I'm standing here. But the journey here was rough. Because at first I was told I would never walk again. And if I did, it would be with a limp. But I'd certainly never run or dance again. And this sent me, as you can imagine, into a severe depression. Became addicted to painkillers. Basically, here's the deal. I looked in the mirror one day at age 21. And what I saw looking back at me was a black, gay, closeted, wheelchair-bound drug addict who frequently, and I don't mean to have any trigger warnings here, but I frequently thought of unaliving myself. Because this world spends a lot of time and a lot of money convincing us that we are unworthy and that we are unlovable and that we are of no value. But we are worthy and we are lovable and we are valuable. So, the question is, who are we spending our time trying to convince of this truth? Look around, look around. How lucky we are to be alive right now. Look around, look around. See, the thing about my recovery was it was the little things, right? The sun kept coming up. My mother had come up to take care of me when I was an outpatient. And one day, I will never forget this. You know, a lot of my days were just spent laying on the floor because my left leg wasn't working, really worse than my right leg. And my mother would just tend to me. She would just bathe me, give me everything I needed. And I wanted a glass of lemonade that my mother had left on the kitchen counter, the high counter, on the other side of the room. And without thinking, I stood up, walked over, and picked it up. And it wasn't some big emotional moment. It just dawned on me like, oh, I'm standing. I took a step. I took a, you know, a little moment happened and changed. And these things come in increments. That's how change comes. That's what RK, the football player, was talking about today. Change comes slowly. But for me, it made me say to my mom, man, all these things that have happened to me, I'm not special. None of us are. We are just here. And my mother, she said, oh, yes, you are special. But not because you're my son or because you're getting better or healing or anything like that. You're special because we are all special. Did you guys hear that? You're special because we are all special. She said, you're special because you're just like everyone else. You're also boring and you're normal, just like everyone else. All these things you think make you different or bad, you're just like everyone else. And Paul, I want you to embrace these circumstances of your life and make sure everyone you come in contact with knows how special they are too. So that was my mission that my mother gave me. She said, folks are gonna talk about you, folks are gonna try to hold you down, they're gonna try and create a story about you. But remember, son, you don't wanna obsess over being cool or belonging or trying to be in the flow. You want to be the flow. You want to be the river that carries and shares truth. So you can imagine years and years and years later, it was crazy that I landed in this little show called Hamilton. Has anybody heard of that? It really, really was. It was just insane. It's not anything I thought would ever come to me. Hamilton came to me, and I played George Washington. Yes, I did. And every night, twice on Saturday, twice on Sunday, I had the great privilege to sing these words to Alexander Hamilton. And I'm going to sing them to you. Let me tell you what I wish I'd known when I was young and dreamed of glory. You have no control who lives, who dies, who tells your story. I know that we can win. I know that greatness lies in all of you, but remember from here on in, history has its eyes on you. Oh, 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 oh. History has its eyes on you. Now, you know I don't get to riff like that when I did the show, but since I'm done with the show, I had to have a little fun. But speaking of the show, let's get on with this show. All right, y'all ready? Have fun at the pre-party, have a little fun over there. All right, I would like to welcome to the stage tonight from Out and Equal Titanium Partner, Apple, Stefan Jansen, Senior Director of Apple Care Systems. It's kind of Oprah. Come on, Stefan, come on out. Stefan.
Hello, out and equal. How was that? Well, honestly, I'm not sure how this big gay fan fell in my hands, but wow, I'm glad I have it, because it is smoking hot in here. What a stunning turnout. Greetings, everyone, and so wonderful to see all of you this gala evening after what's been a transformational and joyous week of summit. I'm Stefan Jansen, and I use he, him pronouns. At Apple, my role involves helping our AppleCare organization provide service and support to our customers around the world. I also have the distinct privilege of being one of the executive sponsors of our Pride at Apple community. Let me give a shout out to my very noisy Apple colleagues here in the room and joining us remotely. Yes. After the past few years, I also want to acknowledge our trans, non-binary, gender non-conforming, and gender expansive communities. I want you to know you are seen, you are heard, and you belong here and everywhere. It's an incredible honor to be here again with all of you continuing the work, the mission, and the movement, not moment, that Out and Equal in the Summit embody. At Apple, we're continuing to create a culture of inclusion, increasing representation across teams, and holding ourselves accountable at every level, because belonging takes all of us. As part of these efforts, we come together to celebrate important cultural moments. But meaningful progress requires more than just celebration, which is why we're inspired by culturally significant moments like Pride Month, International Transgender Day of Visibility, and International Women's Day to move important conversations about inclusion forward. We're committed to these efforts because we have a deep understanding that our differences make us stronger, and we want to continue to create a workplace where everybody belongs, and a workforce that reflects the communities we serve. There's always more to do, and challenges we'll face along the way, but we're so grateful to share the journey with all of you. We are proud supporters of Out and Equal and stand with you to build a better future. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of this brilliant gala.